district that had been conducting the campaign was reorganized and became the Northwestern Army Group, or Front. To command at the operational level, Stalin chose General Semyon Konstantinovich Timoshenko, a former barrel maker, who had proved an effective army commander in the short Polish campaign. Timoshenko's first step was to reorganize the Northwestern Front, creating two armies, 7th and 14th. Once he established a new command structure, he moved in fresh divisions. Like Merezkov before him, he identified a 16-kilometer-wide corridor at Sumer as the best place to effect a breakthrough. Here, he assembled 10 infantry divisions, 5 tank brigades, and 2,800 guns, enough artillery to give him a front-wide ratio of 50 guns per kilometer. During the last weeks of January, Soviet patrols probed the Mannerheim Line, identifying the location of bunkers, and even bringing back pieces of concrete for analysis. On the 1st of February, Northwestern Front's artillery opened up, pumping 300,000 shells into Finnish positions in the first 24 hours. In the Sumer sector alone, 400 shells per minute rained on Finnish positions. Under this crushing bombardment, some of the Finnish fortifications began to crumble. By the 10th of February, the Soviets were attacking all along the line, forcing the Finns into a battle of attrition they could not win. To the alarm of the defenders, Finnish batteries were no longer responding to Russian shelling. The Finns were running out of ammunition, and battery commanders were now under strict orders not to fire, except in cases of dire emergency. Finnish soldiers watched with frustration as masses of Russian infantry deployed to their front, and their guns remained silent. They now had to rely on machine guns, rifles and mortars to prevent a breakthrough. But still, the Mannerheim Line held. The Russians attempted to outflank the line by sending columns across the ice of the Gulf of Finland and Lake Ladoga. Finnish coastal batteries sent armor-piercing shells smashing into the frozen surface. Airbursts of shrapnel tore through the Soviet ranks, pushing them to flee across the fractured ice, where many hundreds drowned. On the 12th of February, a thick fog blanketed the Gulf of Finland. The Russians, advancing under its cover, got to within 50 meters of the Finnish shore when the fog lifted and the defenders' machine guns cut them down in heaps. The Finns still had astonishing successes, but Soviet numbers began to tell. By the second week in February, Finnish reinforcements consisted mainly of 16-year-old boys and reservists in their mid-50s. On the 14th of February, casualties in the Sumer sector reached crisis point, and Mannerheim authorized a withdrawal. But with Sumer gone, the remainder of the front was no longer viable. At 1600 hours on the 15th of February, Mannerheim ordered a general retreat back to an intermediate line, which was much less fortified. There were only two things which could save Finland: the spring and the intervention of foreign powers, particularly Britain and France. Unfortunately, the winter of 1939-40 was one of the coldest and longest of the 20th century. Foreign intervention was proving as illusory as the spring. Some foreign help had arrived, but it was in the form of semi-trained companies and battalions of idealistic volunteers, mainly from Sweden, but with contingents from many other European countries and the United States. On the 29th of February, Finnish diplomats had been on the point of accepting new Russian demands when an urgent message arrived from Paris. The French government urged Finland to fight on and promised the immediate dispatch of 50,000 troops and 100 bombers. On the strength of this promise, the Finns rejected Moscow's offer. But the French offer was dependent on the cooperation of Great Britain, and while Britain wished to send forces to Norway and Sweden to interfere with Germany's supplies of iron ore, London was not necessarily interested in going to Finland to fight the Russians. In addition, any Anglo-French intervention force destined for Finland was going to have to get the permission of the Norwegian and Swedish governments to cross their territory, and this was something Oslo and Stockholm were not prepared to allow. Finland made a desperate appeal to Norway and Sweden to open their borders, knowing that the appeal would be rejected. Finnish diplomats had already decided they had no choice other than to accede to Russian demands, and on the 13th of March signed a ceasefire in Moscow, which which gave Stalin everything he had wanted. The Russo-Finnish War had lasted just 105 days. Finland had lost 25,000 dead and 43,500 wounded, out of a total population of fewer than 4 million. The Soviet losses were much greater, at least 250,000 dead, and about the same number wounded. The Finns took 5,000 Russian prisoners, a surprisingly low number that says much about the severity of the fighting. Though Finland had had to bow to the inevitable, she had earned a reputation as a formidable small power, a nation not to be meddled with. Conversely, even though the Soviets eventually succeeded, the reputation of the Soviet army as a fighting force had been destroyed. American and British observers rated the USSR as a third-rate military power, a hapless giant, incapable of defending itself. So too did the Germans. In fact, in April 1940, the Supreme Military Soviet met to sift through the lessons of the war and push through a program of radical reform. It was just in time. The Russo-Finnish War, the first round of the struggle for Scandinavia, created the conditions in which the Anglo-French War against Germany would spread to Norway. In Britain, the First Lord of the Admiralty, Winston Churchill, had been urging a landing at Narvik on the northwest coast of Norway. This move, ostensibly designed to help the Finns, would threaten Germany's iron ore supplies, dragging Hitler north. It was here that Britain could use her overwhelming naval superiority to wear down German power. The plan had two problems. First, Norway was neutral. Second, Neville Chamberlain and the Foreign Secretary Lord Halifax disliked Churchill's scheme. On the 14th of February 1940, RAF reconnaissance spotted the German auxiliary ship the Altmark in Norwegian territorial waters, steaming south at top speed. Churchill knew she had on board several hundred prisoners taken by the Graf Spee. He decided to rescue them, even at the cost of violating Norwegian neutrality. British destroyers chased the Altmark into a narrow fjord near Stavanger. Then, on Churchill's instructions, blue jackets boarded her and liberated the prisoners. Lord Halifax was horrified. But Britain rallied round Churchill. Edouard Daladier, the French premier, supported Churchill's aggressive Scandinavian strategy. Not only did the defence of Finland unite his fragile government, but Daladier hoped that a Scandinavian expedition would draw the Germans north, away from the Maginot Line. When Finland made peace with the USSR, Daladier was forced to resign after losing a vote of confidence in the Chamber of Deputies. Paul Reynaud formed a new government, but he also faced mounting pressure to wage the war more vigorously. London rejected his proposal to launch an operation in the Caspian and Black Sea area, designed to cut Germany's petroleum supplies. But the British government backed an additional proposal to sow mines in Norwegian territorial waters to stop the ore traffic from Narvik. Mine-laying destroyers slipped out of Scapa Flow, escorted by the battlecruiser Renown, commanded by Admiral Whitworth. Back in Scottish ports, troop-laden warships destined for Stavanger, Bergen, Trondheim and Narvik waited to forestall the anticipated German move. It was a cunning plan. Nearly 4 months earlier,